Now we have a linear camera model which is given by the projection matrix. And so we are ready to calibrate the camera, which essentially means estimate the projection matrix. We do this by using an object of known geometry, such as this one shown right here. This is a cube. We happen to know everything about this cube in terms of its dimensions. It also has a visual pattern on it. And we know the location of every point in this, on this cube, every visual feature in 3D. So what we do is we essentially place our world coordinate frame at one of the corners of this cube. What that means is that once we are done with, say, 3D reconstruction, if that's our application, then all points are going to be measured with respect to this coordinate frame right here. So we have a world coordinate frame right here, and now we take a single image of this cube, which looks like this. So if you consider a single point here, say this point, we know its world coordinates, x, w, y, w, z, w. Let's say that happens to be 0, 3, and 4 in inches in the world coordinate frame. And we know its image location, uv, which is two-dimensional, of course, uv. And that, let's say, happens to be 56 and 115 pixels. So we have this correspondence now. Now we can do the same for all other visual features here. And we can establish the correspondence, which is shown in color right here. This can be either done manually by clicking on points in this image, or one can do it by using an algorithm. Since this pattern is fairly simple, one can imagine writing an algorithm for automatically establishing the correspondence. But irrespective, what you end up with is a set of corresponding points, 3D to 2D. If you take one of these points, you get, through our camera model, linear camera model, you get a mapping from the point in 3D, the world coordinate frame, to the image coordinates right here, 2D, using our projection matrix. This is what we are interested in finding. So U and XW are known, but P is unknown. That's what we are trying to estimate. Now, if you take this expression and you essentially write it out, then you get these two equations, one for u and one for v. The subscript I corresponds to the point we are looking at. So we have many. We go from 1 through n in terms of corresponding points. So for each one of these points, we get an equation, a pair of equations that looks like this. So we can rewrite all of those equations in matrix form as follows, where you have a single matrix where everything is known to us. We'll call that matrix A. And you write your projection matrix in terms of a vector here with 12 elements, and that's what's unknown. So we have the simple form, which is AP equal to 0. Now, before we solve for P, let's take a look at an important property of P, which has to do with its scale. So we know that if you express an image point in homogeneous coordinates as such, and if you simply scale it with some factor k not equal to 0, these two are equivalent to each other, which means they end up giving you the same image coordinates uv. So that means that xw times p, which is equal to this, is equivalent to xw times p multiplied by some scale factor k. That means that the projection matrices p and k times p produce exactly the same homogeneous pixel coordinates. In other words, the projection matrix is only defined up to a scale factor. So what does this really mean? This means that if you have some world and a camera, and you take an image, and now let's say that you double the size of the world in terms of the dimensions of objects, but also the distances between them, and you double the size of the camera, which means the effective focal length, the pixel size, and everything, and you take another image, these two images are going to be identical to one another. That means scaling the projection matrix implies simultaneously scaling the world and the camera, which does not change the image, which goes to say that we can set the scale of the projection matrix arbitrarily. You can choose any scale you wish for the K that we were just talking about. So there's multiple ways to do this. One is we can just choose one of the elements of P, the 12 elements, and simply set that equal to 1. That would be one way to do it. Or we could just say that the square of the magnitude of the vector P is equal to 1. And this is what we choose because it's convenient for us in the way we want to formulate the problem. So we say P squared is equal to 1. So what do we have now? We want AP equal to 0 and P squared equal to 1. And so we can say that we want to find the P, the vector P, that minimizes AP squared such that P squared is equal to 1. And you can see here that this is exactly the problem we solved in the case of finding the homography matrix during image stitching. It's exactly the same problem. It's called the constrained least squares problem. So we use exactly the same approach. We can express AP squared as P transpose A transpose AP, and P squared as P transpose P. So we can now define a loss function, L, which is P transpose A transpose AP minus lambda multiplier times P transpose P minus 1. That's your loss function. And we want to minimize this loss function. In other words, we want to find the P that minimizes L. And how do we do that? We find the derivative of L with respect to P and set that equal to 0. And you get this simple expression right here. And it turns out then that finding the P that minimizes L is equivalent to solving the well-known eigenvalue problem. That's what you're seeing right here. In other words, the P that we're looking for is the eigenvector corresponding to the smallest eigenvalue of A transpose A. We simply take A transpose A and find its eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and the eigenvector that corresponds to the smallest eigenvalue of A transpose A is the projection vector P that minimizes the loss function. So once we have that, we can rearrange the elements of P to get our projection matrix P.